Hello everybody and welcome to the free online version of the Fusion Research Lecture. My name is Alp, this is a YouTube channel called Der Plasma and we are in video number 19. We are in chapter 3, parameter limits for fusion plasmas, and you might remember that in the last video we talked about the stability beta limit arising from ballooning instabilities. In this video we will talk about an additional limit, additional density limit. So, topic of today's video is an additional density limit which arises only in tokamaks. So an additional density limit in tokamaks. And this is really a severe limit, an important limit, because exceeding this limit in the plasma density may lead to disruptions. And you might remember from video number 15 that disruptions is something we want to avoid, especially in a large scale fusion experiment. And this is something which was not theoretically expected or something, but rather experimentally observed and found. So experimentally observed. And there usually there exists the stable parameter ranges where a tokamak can be operated without crossing that density limit is summarized in a certain type of plot. So the stable parameter ranges where a tokamak can be operated without exceeding the density limit is summarized in, I'm pretty sure I'm pronouncing that name wrong, in a Jugel diagram. Maybe it's more like Jugel, yeah, probably. And Jugel came up with that in 1983. And what is that diagram? So on that diagram, we plot, we plot one axis 1 over QS, which is basically, as you remember, proportional to the plasma current. And on the other axis, we plot the so-called Murakami parameter. Parameter that is m bar is equal to n bar r naught over b phi. That basically then is the plasma density. So it's the, if you want, you can bring it down to the plasma current versus the plasma density and machine parameters. Now, how does such a Jugel diagram looks like? Here you can see one. This is, as I said, we have here one over the safety factor against this Murakami parameter. And you can see all these crosses here or symbols. So these are partly diamonds, open diamonds and crosses. These are stable discharges performed in the jet tokamak. And you can see there are a few boundaries. So first of all, there's a boundary towards low values of the density. So this boundary basically is a low density limit. This is a low density limit. And you can explain that by the fact that if you have too little electrons in the beginning when you start to when you're trying to start your discharge, you're basically only accelerating these electrons, And there are two little collisions, two little interactions with the gas to ionize it. So there's no avalanche process. So this is why this limit is also sometimes called runaway limit. Runaway limit. Because what you're basically doing is accelerating a few electrons, and these electrons are getting faster and faster. They are, so to say, they are running away, so they're getting faster and faster without delivering the energy to the plasma. So then we have a limit at 1 over q equal to 0.5 here. And that limit is something which you might remember. This is a limit against external kink instabilities. So this is the limit at a safety factor at the edge, that this is should be larger than 2 to get stability against the external kink mode, against the external kink mode, something which we discussed, I think, 3 videos ago. And then we finally have this kind of this line here, basically. So this one, and this is the phenomenological, as I said, experimentally observed, a phenomenological density limit, which is not completely understood. So if we exceed that limit, if we exceed that density, we might get a disruption, which is something we want to avoid. So this is a phenomenological density limit, which is not completely understood, meaning it is still subject of active research. Okay, let's have a closer look at the density limit. So the density limit. So first of all, we will have a look at a circular tokamak, meaning at a plasma having a circular poloidal cross section. And there we have the so-called, and then the so-called Ugel limit applies. And that is the density is equal to the magnetic field over the safety factor and R naught. And this is, and this is for circular tokamaks. By that I mean tokamaks having a circular poloidal cross section. So that is the Ugel limit, or Ugel limit, I don't know. And if we include the shape, so non-circular cross sections, we get a different limit. So including so-called shaped cross sections, and whenever we read something about shaped cross sections, it means having non-circular cross sections. And cross sections here refer to poloidal cross sections. Then we get a different limit, ng, which is for Greenwald. And that is IP, the plasma current, over pi and a squared. And that is the Greenwald limit. This is an important limitation for tokamaks, basically. Okay, as I said, and this is important, this is why we have to repeat it here, a disruption can occur if we cross that density limit. And this has been not fully understood, but there is an experimentally deduced causality. So there is an experimentally deduced causality. Causality that goes as follows. So in the beginning, before the disruption occurs, an intense radiation from a region at the separatrix is observed. The separatrix, and this happens, as I said, or is observed before, just before we reach that density limit. That radiation is called a MARF. So this is a MARF, and MARF here is short for a multifaceted asymmetric radiation from the edge. And what that is that if we have an increase in radiation, so a lot of radiation coming from the plasma, then what happens is that the temperature drops due to the increase in radiation. So the temperature drops because the energy content of the plasma drops due to the radiation. A drop of the temperature results in a drop in the conductivity. So conductivity drops. That leads to a modification of the current profile. And you might remember that a modification in the current profile, then due to a drop in conductivity, can lead to the occurrence or appearance rather of tearing modes. And you hopefully remember that tearing modes then can finally lead to disruptions. And this is something we want to avoid. Now, can we understand this density limit? Yes, kind of. So it from a physics point of view, it makes sense. So understanding the linear dependence 1 over QS proportional to N, so that the the inverse of the safety factor is proportional to N, which is and that there's a linear dependence between these two, well, as it's written down here, as observed in the experiment. So yes, we can understand that from some simple considerations. First, the ohmic heating in a tokamak, which is the heating due to the current driven by external coils, or by the external transformer rather. So the ohmic heating is due to resistivity. And that scales, so the power of the ohmic heating, OH, ohmic heating, is proportional to the square of the plasma current. Then we have the radiation losses. So radiation losses, and the radiation losses, P rad, they scale with the squared density, with the squared plasma density. And this MARF starts to develop when the ohmic heating power or the radiation of the plasma, when those two are the same at one position in the plasma, usually at the plasma boundary, this is where it happens. And then Q keep in mind that the safety factor at the edge, that this is basically proportional to the magnetic field, B phi, the toroid, the strong toroidal magnetic field over the plasma current. And then we can put all this together, which tells us then that we have start with the inverse of the safety factor, which is, as I have just written it above, the plasma current IP, or proportional to the plasma current over the magnetic field. And this is, as I have written in the, as I've written here, this is then proportional to the square root of the power, the heating power, over the magnetic field again, B phi. And this is then proportional, as I have written it here, to the density over the magnetic field, and et voila, this is the linear scaling as we observe it experimentally. And then to add the other parameters, they come into play when we want to compare different experiments, so comparing of different experiments and being able to plot them on one scaling. This is why we usually then edit an R dependence. And this gives us then finally the Wienwald density limit as we had discussed on the previous slide. Now the interesting thing is, and you might have guessed that from the headline or the title of this lecture, is that this is an additional density limit occurring only in tokamaks. There is no such severe density limit in stellarators. No such severe density limit in stellarators. This is something important to keep in mind. Now, why are we interested generally in higher densities? So as a reminder, the energy confinement time and the energy confinement time scaling according to the so-called ISSO4 scaling tells us that the energy confinement time scales with the plasma density to the power of 0.54, meaning a higher density is beneficial because it results in a higher energy confinement time. Now also in stellarators, the density cannot really get arbitrarily high. So, but the story is a bit different there in stellarators. So what is happening in stellarators? So stellarators, they observe, or you observe in stellarators, a radiative collapse terminating the plasma, course much less violent than in a tokamak where you have a disruption which often then terminates the plasma. What happens during this radiative collapse when the density is getting too high? So radiative collapse basically is that the power radiated away from the plasma is or exceeds the heating power, which results then in a sudden decrease of the stored energy of the in the plasma stored energy, resulting in a sudden termination of the plasma basically. The point, however, here is that the radiated power is usually due to impurities, That means this is something we can control, we can modify, so we have an influence on that. And this kind of radiative limit is referred to as the pseudo limit, or sometimes also to the radiative density limit. You will find both these expressions in literature. So we have the pseudo limit or the radiative density limit occurring in a, oops, sorry, occurring in a stellarator. And this is, as I said, something different to a tokamak, because in contrast to a tokamak, we can push this limit higher. We can push the density higher by, for example, wall conditioning. Wall conditioning, which reduces the impurities, which allows us to get a cleaner plasma. Or in general, by adapting different experimental scenarios. And these are methods which allows us to achieve higher densities. So we can push the density limit much higher in a stellarator. And this is why this is rather an operational limit, depending on the scenario you're running in your stellarator, and not such a severe thing as in a tokamak. Okay, that's it for lecture 19, for video number 19, where we talked about an important additional density limit in tokamaks. This was the so-called Greenwald density limit, something which is not completely understood, thus being still a topic of active research. I told you, and this is important to keep in mind, that when we pass that density limit, we usually get a disruption in the tokamak, something we want to avoid. Interestingly enough, this limit does not appear in a stellarator. In a stellarator, we have something slightly different. We get a radiative collapse if the density gets too high, because usually then the radiative power increases as well, the power radiated away by the plasma, but we can reduce that by tuning the operational scenario, or sorry, in general, tuning the plasma chamber, for example, by proper wall conditioning. So this is not such a severe limit as in the tokamak, and we can push stellarators to much higher densities. Okay, that's it. Hope to see you in the next video.